So, teacher and leadership, when it comes to the version of the plan, you never ever specify in the discipline. So drop that whole deal from your business as a general lighting system. So don't even think about it, that type of light. Teacher inefficient, they can get them by multiple voltages, multiple watts. You can read the watts, you can get them as high as 400, 500 watts and so forth. Very inefficient, you're not going to be reason. A couple of things is they have, and then with these, they're going to start disconnecting manufacturing incandescent lamps. I can't remember what the date is, but the feds are supporting getting rid of all these incandescent lamps. They will still be used, guys, for fridges and low voltage, low watts, for certain application inside a fridge, for example, fridge light or microwave light and some. But for the general lighting, building lighting is our business. I will bring your attention, guys, to page 11. Page 11, it says incandescent filament types. That little heater, it comes in different shapes and sizes and all this good stuff. So if you look at page 11, please, figure 2.1, it shows you the code number for each one of these heaters, the heating elements, like C9, how C9 looks like, C6, CC6, and C17. And they keep adding different heaters, guys, to get you different amount of watts and make it more efficient. So if you look at page 11, just a couple of heaters. If you go to page 12, they have the filaments for these incandescent lamps. They come in so many shapes, ways that you can't imagine. If you guys look incandescent lamp base types, E12 is CAD screw, intermediate E17, and they have letters for each one of them and designation. You don't need to know that, but at least look at the first one is a screw end, the others are push end, C, D, DC, B, or so there's so many types, just FYI. Different types of sockets. I don't even want to spend time on it because, again, for what we do, Spencer, construction lighting, these are out of the picture for the most part, really out of the picture. Therefore, and you will see to meet the energy code, guys, which is getting more and more as we get towards being tree huggers and chicken huggers and so forth, and energy efficient nation, guys. All these stuff are coming out of business. All these inefficient things in some land. So these are the size. In page 13, I want to bring your attention to a little bit, guys. Incandescent lamp shapes, the shape that they come up with. If you look at the R shape, way at the bottom, guys, it's like an apple. The R shape, PSC, the smartest people groups that chapter, they decided every shape they give a letter. So every time you see a C, incandescent lamp C, it looks like if you guys look at the C, the color room. So they identify them by codes, the manufacturer standards. So if you need a CA, lamp, it will look like if you guys look at the CA, that little whatever shit is that would be. PAR, PAR lamp, these are the ones that you put the big can type of light. So anyway, the only thing I'm gonna bring to your attention is the shape identification letters that comes in each one of them. In each one. With incandescent, before I move on, guys, they added because it's very inefficient, they add a gas to it and they make it the halogen gas. They add to this heater and they make it glows and be more efficient. To make it more efficient, they add halogen to it and they call it tungsten halogen. Tungsten halogen, guys, is more efficient type of an incandescent lens. They use them in cars and they use them in a couple of other industries. But for the most part, still incandescent is not energy efficient compared to the other sources of power. So you can almost, what they do is they add the halogen gas inside that bulb to treat the light and get you more efficiency out of the light. I'm not going to bring to your attention that this light will looks like this, right? Is my lighting fixture, and here's your, you got a heating element inside it, and it glows. So whatever grade you put in it is you tweak it to make it more efficient.
Any question on 190 and the lights? I don't want to spend too much time on that. We are using our project just as a spotlight in certain areas, spotlight that as a general light. Any question about these heaters inefficient? You can treat them with some halogen to make them more efficient, but for the most part, I think probably for the most part, I can't remember, but I would say 80% of the energy is lost. 80% of the energy in an incandescent lamp is lost. So you're only utilizing 20, probably 30%. If you want the glow in the incandescent lamps, you're only utilizing 20 to 30% of it as light. What's the rest of it doing? Cooking your eggs. So you just cooking them, or it's a heater. So that's why it's very, very inefficient source of, especially for commercial. Any question about the incandescent lamps before I move into condensate? If you just look at page 14, just another shapes for condensate, halogen, quartz lamp shapes. There's a bunch of them there. They're still used for certain applications, but they're not general lighting lights. More efficient than the incandescent by itself, but still not your best type of lights. Okay, any question about this? In terms of source, again, we dropped it. The second two guys, this one is very easy. They call them, this one up here. These sources, they're divided, they're arc, all of them are arc. Look how they divide them. All of them are arc because they created an arc. From here end, these are called arc lamps. All of them are arc lamps. They create, unlike the heaters, where the current goes through, the little resistor and heating and glows, these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sources, you create power by arcing. You create an arc, all of them, the four types. The difference between this one is they call it low, these four they call high intensity discharge. These guys are low intensity discharge. Fluorescent are called low intensity discharge, and high intensity discharge is for the last four: metal halide, mercury, high pressure, and low pressure sodium. Meaning the arc is being high intensity discharge, low intensity discharge. So these are very important. Number one is to understand that some arc, what they do is they heat two little sources, guys, and they create electrons who start shooting from one source atom to another atom, and in between they create an arc, which is the worst thing that could happen in an electrical system. You don't want an arc. So you create an arc and they put a balance, guys, to the balance that they use is they increase the voltage so high to create the arc, and then when the arc is established, it chokes the current to maintain the arc, because if the current is so high in the lamp, what happens to the circuit breaker? It traps, it thinks it's a short circuit. So that's where the whole arc, you heat two elements, they start shooting electrons between each other, create an arc, there's no heating element between the two sides. The hot and neutral guys are not touching each other. You create it here, you shoot in between, create an arc, and then you create an arc. Different type of arc, high, low intensity, high intensity arc based on them, and then you treat them to get your light. So like when you So you get UV out of all these, you get UV light, and then you get UV light, you treat to get physical, visible spectrum. All of them, guys, give you some type of a UV light, you treat the UV light to get you a visible spectrum in different ways in different gases. Unlike the incandescent light, no treatment needed to get the light, directly into the visible spectrum. These guys, most of the light is generated in the UV, which is invisible. Then you treat it with phosphorus and get you into the visible spectrum. Why do we need the visible spectrum? So we can see Mr. Urban. Otherwise, if we are looking at Mr. Urban under UV light, you can't see it under an UV light. Does that make sense, guys? All of our arc, low, high, they create UV, you treat the UV and to get you into the visible. That's kind of the science behind it. The science behind it. Any question about this? Any question? For fluorescent soap, I put it in the because that kind of gets you into the room of arc lamps, all your arc lamps, all your arc lamps. I'm just talking about with the fluorescent lights, guys, right now with the D8, or D5 is the most common types of lamps that you know. And we all know that you start eating the atoms and you start chewing at each other with electrons, and that's the arc you treat. The bulb right above your head with some phosphorus, and that convert the UV to visible spectrum so we can see. That's basically the science behind it. Any question you have on this about the fluorescent? Fluorescent, we'll talk about the use and all the stuff, but for the most part, T5, T8 is the most important ones in the fluorescent. In the fluorescent lamps. All of them are arc.
Dimensions, 8, 5, 12.
Yeah, these are divided, the diameter divided by 8. So T8 is the diameter of a T8 is divided by 8, give you an inch. T5 is 5 divided by 8, 5/8. T12 is an inch and a quarter, 12 divided by 8. So they're all standardized as when you see a T8, guys, that's a good point. When you see a T5, the diameter equal 5 over 8. And this one, the diameter of this boy equal 8 over 8. So in this case, 1, and in this case, obviously, 5/8 of an inch. Give you the diameter. Any questions about these? The fluorescent lights. You're going to get single fluorescent lights, guys, when we specify them later on. When we go to use the software, there's so many shapes and remember we talked about cooling color and warm color yesterday, the Kelvin? These are directly related to the cool light, the fluorescent lights. Directly related to the fluorescent lights. Before I forget about fluorescent lights, guys, I want you to, so we got that one, we know how it looks like. I like to know the cameras. If you guys look at page 16, again, they treat the UV with phosphorus to get you like invisible. So if you look at page 16, please, fake 2.5 lamp lumen maintenance care for typical fluorescent lamps, thousands of hours of operation versus lumen maintenance. How much lumen is going to be maintained? There are two types of phosphorus. There are two cares. Can you guys say the top? This is the best phosphorus that you can treat the inside of the bulb with. Why it's the best? Because over the life of the fixture, the lumen stays almost constant. Look at that. Over the life of the fixture, the lumen stays almost constant. This bad one, the common phosphorus, over the life of the fixture, what do you do to the phosphorus, the lumen, how many lumens you can convert from UV into visible spectrum? It goes down as with, like at 10,000 hours, you're almost 55%. So this was supposed to give you 100 lumen, guys. After 55 hours of after 10,000 hours of work, if we use this common phosphorus, base phosphorus, that will go down to 55 lumens. Bad news. Not a big deal for us because we make these for the most part. Now, guys, the manufacturers make the best ones for us. I will bring to your attention that all of them they need ballast. All these arcs they need a ballast. The ballast has two jobs: pump the voltage high to start the arc, jump number two. When the arc is established, they choke the current to maintain the arc. Because if you don't choke the current, Brad, what happens to the circuit breaker? It trips, because it thinks that arc is actually a short circuit or a ground fault. It trips. So, start the arc, maintain the arc. That's really the job of the ballast for the most part. All of them need a ballast. Versus incandescent lights, you don't need a ballast with it. different shape, different form, different colors, because if you read through it, they come in different colors, different shapes, and different forms, and so forth. We will talk about CU and when we start other places, but for the most part, this is what I want to. Fluorescent light, guys, other than LEDs, and I really encourage you guys to inquire about LEDs. If somebody wants to design the project with LEDs indoor, it is still the fluorescent that we specified for you. Completely go for it if you can find the lumens, which probably in some search you should be able to find the IES funds. The critical thing about the fixtures that you're going to pick. Spencer's, can I find an IES file for it? Why? Because if I find the IES file, I can pull it into the virtual software and then do a foot candle calculation in the building. So before you think of using any fixture, please always go find the IES file. Can I find an IES file for that fixture so I can pull it into the software and do a calculation? If you can't find an IES file, then I don't want you to use a fixture because you can't use it in terms of calculation. Which for the most part, guys, with LEDs, you should be able to do some searching or you can contact the manufacturer. I have no doubt that they do an IES file for them. Okay, so that is very for fluorescent. Another thing you guys want to fluorescent too is this, for the most part, the fluorescent lights are indoor light source. And again, we're talking commercial. For the most part, you can agree in indoor, but for the most part, they are indoor type, indoor application, dry location, exactly like one unit. For the most part, you can use them outside, but for the most part, they are indoor type, working horse type of fixture, right above your head, T5, T8, three lamps, four lamper, troffer like this one. That's the cheapest piece of equipment you can put in a commercial building, literally. So, with T5, four lamps, T5, with the electronic balance, with a troffer like this one, lenses, different type of lenses, we'll talk about this one, that's as good as you can get, and as cheap as you can get in a commercial building. If you don't want to go fancy with LEDs and basket and all this good stuff. Any question about fluorescent? So, if I can say one thing, Spencer, I would say fluorescent is your fixture of choice for indoor commercial buildings. First, your fixture of choice, really. LEDs are getting it. The working on the LEDs will be a fixture of choice. But this is your fixture of choice if you're doing a commercial building in Europe, to start with. Any question about fluorescent? Again, I'm not going to emphasize to you, you've seen them. They can come linear and 2 foot, 4 foot, or they can come circular, different shapes. Compact fluorescent, now you can screw in time, so they can come in a lot of shapes and so forth. Any question about fluorescent before we move into the mercury and the vapor and the metal halide and high pressure and low pressure sodium? So this is an indoor. We see this is an indoor. For the most part, guys, these are an outdoor. Again, for the most part, parking lots, streets, highways, interstates, for the most part, obviously, for the most part, or a very big application for them, or large open spaces. Large open spaces, for the most part, outdoor or large open spaces like manufacturing floor. And I used to tell the students that large open spaces like manufacturing, but now guys, fluorescent, you've seen that T5, what is it, 6 foot or eight, I mean 6 lamps or 8 lamp fixture, they can have a 6 lamp fixture, T5 fixture, that can replace all metal halide and high pressure sodium in any location with more efficiency and better performance. So, but for the most part, guys, these type of fixtures, for the most part, are outdoor fixture, large open spaces, for the most part. LEDs are invading in Spencer. LEDs, you can buy LEDs for speeds right now. I think, what is it, the bridge, 35W bridge, the light on the 35W bridge is LED light. So they're invading the outdoor, the indoor, and everything else. So hopefully it will be in the future. Mercury, because we just got sick of flea-bitten frogs coming into our lakes and rivers, so they got rid of the mercury. It's the first one ever invented, so when you see mercury, because it's a good fixture, but you don't want to use it obviously because of the environmental impact. So drop that mercury business. Your options then are, when you go inside and outside, you really have two options. Either metal halide, if you want to go high in this discharge, or high pressure sodium. Metal halide or high pressure sodium. I will talk about low pressure sodium in a second here. So we dropped mercury because of what? Because of the mercury, the three electrons, we don't want them. So the second choice is for us, is these two. So if you are having an outdoor fixture, and this is an LED light, which is great, I encourage you to do it, LED fixtures. If you don't want to be here, you will stay within budget and the cheapest piece of equipment and the most efficient of design. You most likely will be a metal MH type of fixture. All the fixtures that we use in the project that we use in the past is MH metal halide. Very efficient equipment, cheap to buy. The reason why metal halide is really good is also higher, color rendering index. It gives you color discrimination between objects. So it's really good optimum design if you use this one. The second best would be your high pressure sodium. It's a little bit higher on the yellow part. So the second option would be for you is high pressure sodium. So if you're doing a parking lot, or if you're doing an indoor open space, and you decided to use high in this discharge fixture because it's the cheapest, and I'm not only going to say that because it is really changing, and I encourage you guys when there is an associate comes over here to ask them, they have the most updated information, and they swear now the fluorescent indoor, the fluorescent 6 lamp T5s are much more efficient, more superior to metal halide indoor, metal halide indoor. They're replacing them. A lot of people are replacing metal halide and high pressure sodium with a 6 lamp T5 electronic ballast driven fixture. And when you go there, there's an associate, you'll look up at a few of them. How many of you guys have seen the T5 6 lamps? You probably have seen them all. So they're really cool. Okay, but if you're looking for, and I don't use the word more efficient, if you decided to go high discharge, metal halide, high pressure sodium is your, and I have a couple of curves, I'll show you guys the difference between them in a second. Why? The reason why I go to low pressure sodium at the end, anyone, if you read the chapter, anybody knows what the problem with low pressure sodium? Color rendering index is almost zero. You cannot see things underneath the colors. You can see things, but you can't discriminate against colors. So low pressure sodium, and I use the word loosely, could be an interstate highways good fixture, because if you're driving, you don't care if the car next to you, when you're driving at 75 miles an hour, do you really care to look at the car, is it blue or green at night? You care, can I see it clearly? Yes, it's an object right in front of you, avoid it. So that would be low pressure sodium for years, guys. It's an option of interstates and highways and so forth, because color rendering index is not an issue when you're driving at 85, 75 miles an hour. And it's very efficient, the most efficient. The reason why they use it, the most efficient is low pressure sodium, the most efficient fixture, other than LEDs, obviously, and induction lights are the more efficient LEDs. But with these traditional lights, guys, low pressure sodium is the most efficient. But what's the drawback? You put your car outside and you can't find it. If you're in a parking lot at night, good luck finding your parking lot. Well, some people will say, yeah, that's why a buzzer. But for the rich people who has a buzzer, it works. But for the poor people like Chad, who still have the traditional way of finding his car, good luck. Even during the day, how many of you guys have lost your car during the day? What do you think, park at the Mall of America? Which spot? So. Any question? I like to put them all together, so it gives you the big picture with all these fixtures. So Spencer, my friend, your lighting fixture of choice, metal halide, indoor, open, major open space, or outdoor. Next will be high pressure sodium, low pressure sodium. If you're using speed, do it. If you design it to be environmentally friendly and you want to avoid all this one, here's your two options, obviously, LEDs. And if you put this one, I'm going to put 6, 7 here, will be LED, and E is induction. Induction. Anybody ever seen induction light? really interesting at the moment, at the convention center, when we had the Midwest, what do you call it, Midwest electrical expo. They had a lot of application, and this where the guys will make it. It works with induction like motors, guys. It induces magnetic field, and from this magnetic field, they create light. They make the way I understand it, I could be completely wrong, but the magnetic field that they induce, it goes through like a little bulb, and that magnetic field creates light after you treat it. That's a word induction. So it's more and more environmentally friendly, top-notch, get green design building. Most of the time, almost always, you're going LEDs. LEDs, guys, right now, they have them indoor, and outdoor. So you can use them for a parking lot if you want to, or you can use them for a room like this. What's the drawback of this? Expensive. That's the drawback of LEDs. Any question, guys? So the last two are your options, more efficient. But they're expensive, obviously. And the rest of them, so you really, guys, to summarize everything that you have to, right now you have two options with your commercial building, right now, unless you use it. You have three options. Either use fluorescent, which is the cheapest piece of equipment, and put it indoor, all fluorescent lights. Or if you have an open space indoor, you can metal halide, it's cheap, still cheap. Or if you want to, don't care about the price, and it'll be environmentally friendly, and you're a tree hugger like Chad, you're going to go all the way with LEDs or induction. Any question, guys? Any question? I separated them. LED is not an arc lamp and not a heater, guys. They put them through a diode, and the diode will glow. Some type of a, like a heater, but an induction is not an arc. It's an induction. It creates a magnetic field, and that magnetic field, the way I understand it, creates the really cool light. So I can't emphasize the word arc lamps versus heaters versus LED versus induction. These are three types of, or four types of fixtures. Any question, my friends? Any question about these? When we start using visual, you will need even here, M, M, H. You see a fixture that's called M, H, W, L. Metal halide, high pressure sodium, HPS, high pressure sodium. You're going to see HPS on the fixture. NaN, that will indicate to you the high pressure sodium. Between these two fixtures, you all, unless you know what you need, this is all what you're going to do outdoor. For indoor lights, you will use fluorescent lights. Most of the fixtures that we're using are fluorescent light fixtures. With this, and please read the chapter, guys. Reading the chapter is a summary by itself. There's a couple of graphics for you and how the light looks, and everybody knows, and you know, metal halide and so forth. I want to bring your attention to a couple of graphics that I think are good. So if you want to read 19, please, with me, please. There is a drawback of low intensity discharge versus low intensity discharge, and that's why the word blue, guys, versus light. Low intensity discharge are fluorescent. High intensity discharge are all these mercury, drop of mercury, metal halide, nitrogen, sodium. The drawback for these guys, they need time to warm up to start giving 100% efficiency. So that's the drawback of this. Metal halide, high pressure sodium, and low pressure sodium. All of these, they need time to come up to speed. It's like motors. They don't, you know, flip them and they come 100% light. They need a couple of minutes to warm up to give you a 100% light. Anyway, so that's very important to remember about high intensity discharge. And Brad, believe it or not, this is a drawback. This is a drawback for high intensity discharge. That's why fluorescent lights, six T5s in one lighting fixture like this, is superior right now to high intensity discharge. One of the major things that they're superior, they don't need to warm up. Number one, you don't need to warm up, turn them on, and they're almost instantly completely on, 100% lumens, 100% light. And then you know what the other drawback is. What happens if you turn, look at the fluorescent light. You turn the fluorescent light off, turn it on. Look at that, in almost instantly, 100%. What happens if you go high intensity discharge lamps? You turn it off after 2 hours of work and turn it on. Has anybody ever done that? It takes 15 minutes to cool down and come up back to speed, close to 10 to 15 minutes. Mental hemorrhage. If a mental hemorrhage was running for 2 hours, and you turn it off, I'm not going to be stupid to turn it off, but there might be an outage in the area, and you turn it off, right? You turn it off, turn it on again, it will take 10 to 15 minutes for it to cool down, and then start the whole process of shooting, and starting the arc again to come to 100% limits. Is that a bad idea? Of course it's a bad idea. That's why fluorescent lamps are invading the territories of these lamps and LEDs. Because people don't want this one. You don't want to turn it off and then you need to wait 15. What about the safety? You have, when we go to the industrial project, we're manufacturing floor here, people are working on repairing equipment. That could be dangerous. What happens if you have an outage and you lost the power? The light momentarily, just momentarily, and the light comes back. Now, all the lights in that manufacturing floor are down for 15 minutes. Yeah, I never working on equipment. That's why for emergency, a couple of things to remember, hot and diesel discharge are not approved as an emergency source of power. So can I use a mercury light as my emergency light? No, because when it was on and you turn it off and you turn it on again, it will take 15 minutes. And for emergency lights, they have to come up to speed within, anybody remember? 10 seconds. For lighting system, an emergency lighting system in any area has to come up with 10 seconds. So how do you use a mental halide as an emergency light? If you turn it, it takes 5 minutes to come on. If it's cold, it will up to 5 minutes to come on. And if it was hot, and you turn it off, turn it on again, it will take up to between 10 to 15 minutes to cool down and come up to speed. So please write yourself a note. These are non-emergency type fixtures. You don't use them. The high intensity discharge. Low intensity discharge, the fluorescent all the time. You can use fluorescent as an emergency light. If you look at the heat in page 19, look at 2.8 warm-up characteristics of different mercury vapor, and you almost think this quality is slightly better than that. You look at the upper left corner, warm-up characteristics of mercury, and once you guys look at the lamp voltage, the light output, that's the lumen, and the lamp ends. I want you to look at point zero, at point zero, as you start turning on the light. Look at the voltage will be very low, close to 20% of its rating. Right? Look at the current. The current is 160% current, so there's a hemorrhage. That's your hemorrhage. The current is very high as you start the fixture. Very high hemorrhage. And then, can you see that? Look at the first. The light output as you start the fixture. The fixture is off. My fixture is off right now. When you start the fixture, at this point, as I start, the output was zero. The light was zero. The voltage as you limit 20%, and the current jumps to 160% external. Why hemorrhage? And now you can add between 0 and 1 minute, all the way up to 3 minutes. Can you see how the voltage starts going ramping up to reach the 100% voltage by 20? The light starts ramping up, so it was 2,000 lumens on the voltage. Now it started with 200 lumens, and over 3 minutes, I reached all the way to 2,000 lumens. And the lamp amp, look at the amps. The amps was so high as I started the air rush, and it went all the way down close to 3.4 minutes. Everything went to 100%. So the voltage is 100% where it should be, the lumen is 100%, and the current 100%. That's what you want. Does that make sense? So this graph, guys, and I can't emphasize how easy it will be searched by my design. It's very important, guys. Really important. Keep in mind there is a starting time for this type of question. Okay, page 19 at the bottom, 2.9, lumen and light characteristics of mercury vapor. If PM has, as we talked guys later on, you have to pay attention to the light and the maintenance of the fixture, light and maintenance. So if you look at the lumen and light characteristics, approximately, let's say, this is for a mercury vapor, and in 5 hours, going to make a scare. If you look after 1 to 5 hours, what happened to the lamp still burning? Percentage of lamp still burning. So 60% after 24 hours, I'm looking at the first period, after 24 hours, 24,000 hours, I will have close to 60% of the lamps are still burning. So if I have 100 lamps, all of them are mercury, and they burn for 24 hours, should I tell him or not? There is a certain amount of there not there. I will find 60 women still burning. What happened to the others? They died. Look at the characteristics. Look at the maintenance care. Look at the maintenance care, guys. Is how much money over the life of a fixture you can get on beauty and pizza. Expensive. This is going to give you 3,000 lumens. Do you think you're going to get one 3,000 lumens and be 5 years from now 3,000 lumens? Obviously not. It's going to go down. So this is how when you age, the mixture will age, guys, and the lumen, the life around the mixture will go down. Obviously, will reduce. But I'm age. Look at chance. My speed is going to reduce. So we'll come next year. Okay, I want you guys to look at the second curve, right then, 24 volt and 24,000 hours. Look at the range varies with bells, but look at what happened to, I'm going to look at the initial loading. The bottom of the curve, after 24 hours of that part of the fixture, if I have 100 loading coming out of it, after 24,000 hours, guys, you get only 40%, which is 40 loads coming out of that fixture. And then the shading area is because of differences between those and so forth and switching. Long story short, that will bring all of us back to over time, the fixtures will lose units. When I start using the software and we have an LL factor, life loss factor, or life loss factor, when you turn the life loss factor for fluorescent, it's going to be 82%. This is what they're talking about, only that the life of the fixture, the lumen, will decrease. It's chemistry, it's physics. It will decrease, guys. Does that make sense? That's why certain NAMs, guys, every 2 years or so, they will rehab the whole fixture, the whole buildings, and the detection points. So they can decrease the lumens. As you start decreasing, they will rehab it all put together, or change the ballast. Rehabbing is the most common ones. Okay, so these are a few things, guys, I want to bring to your attention. These green curves, are really nice to read. Page 20, please. The same thing, guys, the same here for vapor NAMs, which is, so this is for high-intensity discharge line. I have metal halide and high-pressure sodium. Combining the high-pressure sodium with metal halide with mercury. So I want you to put it on the curve, guys. And again, thousands of hours versus initial loading. Which way will maintain its loading for a longer amount of time? Looking at these three times. Metal halide, high pressure sodium, and mercury. The first one is mercury. Can anybody tell me? We're just looking at the curves. High pressure sodium, can you see that you need the curve to be flat? If the curve is too sharp, goes down, back loop, you're losing loading faster. Does that make sense? So that's really nice. So that's what you're looking at this curve. 24,000 after 24,000 hours, a high pressure sodium gas can maintain up to 80% of its value. That's great. If you can, after 24,000 hours of work, if I can maintain 80% of the efficiency of my employees, or that would be great. Can't maintain it for 5 hours sometimes. Any questions about these curves? Lumens versus working hours. Lumens versus working hours. So just looking at this curve, guys, high pressure sodium is superior in terms of maintaining its what? Lumens over the life of the fixture. Okay, one more thing, and I'm going to look at this. Here is our most important thing, page 21, and I'm going to give you a break. I know you dry. Page 21, I want you to look at that upper right corner here. It says one characteristics of high pressure sodium. That's my best picture in terms of opening the spaces and outdoor. One characteristics, minutes of warm up, look how long will it take that fixture to warm up? 6 minutes. The lighting output takes 6 minutes. If you look at the lamp amps in the inrush, if you just look at this here, this here of the inrush is better, lower than the inrush of the mercury. And it takes longer for the fixture to warm up. So high pressure sodium, it takes it up to 6 minutes to come up to speed. 6 minutes to come up to speed. Just to give you an idea, guys, if you want to make it 6 minutes, 6 minutes is an eternity. A motor, if I have a 50 horsepower motor driving a chiller here, 50 horsepower motor, normally it takes 10 seconds. Motors are waiting for 10 seconds to come up to speed. 10 seconds, up to 10 seconds. These guys are taking 10 minutes, 6 minutes to two or one. So you can just compare a motor efficiency or net efficiency and stuff. Yeah. But you know, how often you turn these like on? You don't turn on them. You turn them on at the beginning of the end, up at the end of the end. You never turn one on. Except now with the efficiency. When we build things on associates, guys, we talk about lighting efficiency because we're becoming more green nation and we're going to save energy. They're putting occupancy sensors on high-heat discharge. And then you're putting occupancy sensors in high-heat discharge, turning on and off. Number one, you're going to reduce the life expectancy with them. Number two, you turn them off, coming on the end. If somebody's walking the aisle and you want a high discharge to come on, you will walk out of the aisle before that sucker comes on. So that's a disadvantage. That's why fluorescent lights are becoming superior. You have a fluorescent light, I can get that condition as low as I want, or I can turn it off if somebody's moving in this aisle to save some energy. If a spinster is going to buy some underwear or something in this aisle, you go right, walk in there, and that light will go on. As you leave it, it stays there on for 10 minutes, then it turns off. So I can't emphasize, guys, why fluorescent is becoming superior for these type of fixtures, because as we become more energy efficient nation, high-end discharge are not meant to be turned on and off. Still, there's a lot of place for them for manufacturing, for example. A manufacturing floor, they open at 7:30 and they close, say, at 4:30. The light continue on, people are working, you don't want to dim the light or turn the light off. That's an ideal application for metal halide lighting fixture. Ideal application. You don't dim, you don't want to turn it on and off. Efficiency is not a big deal because you're manufacturing. And by the way, these manufacturing floors are exempt from the energy code. If you go to the energy code, you don't need to apply energy code on manufacturing floors. These are making goods and good stuff. Offices not, but manufacturing floors are exempt from. So don't worry about turning one on off or dimming it. Okay, the last thing I want to show you guys here before I give you a quick break here, the last page 22. In page 22, there's a really nice graphic comparison between these fixtures. If you look at the efficiency of the fixture, guys, what's the efficiency of the fixture? Or efficacy. Efficacy is how much lumen per watt each one of them can deliver. So that's what we're looking at the fixture. I want you to look at the incandescent. Incandescent is 20 lumens per watt. Every time you burn a watt, you get 20 lumens out of it. Bad idea, right? Look at the mercury vapor, 155, that's a jump, good jump. And fluorescent, 100, that's a good jump too. And then we have 121, that's a better. High pressure sodium, 140, that's why high pressure sodium is superior. Low pressure sodium is 200. That's why low pressure sodium is considered superior. You can, for every watt that you burn, for every watt you burn, what's the drawback of this, guys? That low pressure sodium, you can't distinguish between colors. So this is one way of looking at the fixtures, guys. The other way is of life expectancy too. There's a carrier for life expectancy. And you know what, Spencer? If you look at these carriers, the way they're now the lighting fixture will source is far arranged. Always you can always arrange them the same way in terms of life expectancy. So meaning the long high performance, what you call the high pressure, low pressure sleep will live longer in terms of maintenance almost. In terms of price, the same way the lower you go down, the more expensive the fixture will be, obviously. You're getting a low fixture. In terms of maintenance, the same way, if you go down, the more you go down, the more maintenance it takes. You need, you know, high pressure sodium, need maintaining it and change ballast and change lamps much more than an incandescent light on this. So, high pressure sodium, low pressure sodium is superior in terms of efficiency, guys. In terms of life, it lives forever. But what's the drawback of that, boy? Color rendering index zero, almost zero, and it's expensive, and it takes more to maintain that boy over a long time. Any question I can't emphasize? There's a lot of other stuff that I didn't cover, guys, details, but I'm interested in the big picture. Can you guys see the big picture from here? If you look through the whole presentation, two things remember. Fluorescent lights and metal halide high pressure sodium. For your outside, metal halide high pressure sodium. For your inside, fluorescent lights. And fluorescent lights are also inviting the inside application of metal halide.
The outside application of metal, the outside parking lot, guys, fluorescent, especially in our climate here, they're still not the best. You can't, because of cold weather outside. So you still have metal halide high pressure sodium outside, is still superior outside.
Any question, my friends, about unit number two?
So please, I hope you guys will enjoy it. It's really not very simple summary. I can't summarize it more than it's already summarized. 5 minutes break. Yeah, thank you. I want to go over chapter three, guys. Talk about luminaires.
Luminaires, chapter three. Or unit number three. We're talking lighting. Luminaires, that. I think in 2000, I can't remember if it's in 2005, I believe, they got rid of the lighting fixture in the NEC code book, and they start synchronizing the IES standards in lighting with the NEC code book. So it's luminaires right now in the NEC code book, respected piece of equipment. I want to talk, in this chapter, guys, there's a few information. I want to talk about a few things here. First of all, what is a luminaire? The stuff that made a luminaire. If you have a luminaire, these are things that you're going to find in a luminaire. You're going to find a housing, number one. Number two, you're going to have reflector. Reflector. Number three, my friends, you're going to have diffuser or louvers or diffusers. Number four, Muhammad, of course, the most important thing in the picture is what? Lamp. You have to have a lamp, the source of lamp. Number five, you have to have a balanced, or some of them, most of them, balanced. And number six, you have to have power connection. Connection. Box or something. Box sometimes to power connection. Okay, so this, when we talk guys about a lighting fixture, you are looking at six items in this lighting fixture. Really, six items. If you look at the one above your head, Spencer, I always pick up my friend Spencer, you have the housing, that retail. The housing guys is supposed to protect you, the fixture, the lamp, and everything else from the elements, from you, you know, accidentally moving and you're busting that fluorescent lamp. So that's the housing is mainly for protection, safety, and so I'm going to write right here. This is protection. Protection. Housing to house the fixture for protection. Then you have reflector, diffuser. Reflectors and diffusers. If you guys, I don't have anyone, if you open that diffuser there above your head, you can see that there is that laminated piece of sheet of is it steel or what do you call it? Laminated metal that actually reflects the light. As the light came out of that lamp, it bounces off this reflector and pushes it down to where you want the light to go. So the reflector directs the lights. Very important, guys. Reflectors can make the light more or less efficient. So reflectors. Diffusers and louvers, so this is reflector is to direct the light. Direct light. And I don't know about you, Brad, but if I want to lift this surface, I will direct the light here, right? Directly to the surface that I will lift. I don't want to direct the light on this area if I don't want to. Right here, this is we want to because we're working this. But you will know that the reflector is always directing the light down. Well, it doesn't have to be downward, directing it toward the area that I need to light. Does that make sense? Diffusers, yes, sir.
Residential, if somebody's designing a house, do you think they take all this into consideration?
Into consideration for a house?
The amount of lumens that are going to be covered.
No, not unless it's a big house.
Somewhat.
Unless it's really a big house. I always say, if you have a room, every room surface mounted lighting. If I have a house, surface mounted lighting fixture, two lamps, 60 watt each, or 23 watt with these compact fluorescent right now, two lamps right in the center of a room. Like, see, the room is 10 by 10, all what you need to get a sufficient amount of
general. High-end houses, you have to take into consideration.
If you would do what?
Doing high-end houses.
Yeah, unless you're doing.
Yeah.
You can. All these fixtures, you can. Not that I know of. Unless it's, you have it managed, not that I know of.
So this only gets like
commercial, industrial, yeah. Commercial, industrial. Like this room here, you have to do the calculation to come up with the number of fixtures. You have to. Okay, so housing to protect the fixture. By the way, when they say protection, protecting the fixture, the lamp, protecting the lamp, and the ballast, mainly. Okay, now anybody knows what the diffuser and the louvers are? These are diffusers right above your head. Rooms, as you know, these are called diffusers. Anybody know the louvers? The louvers are the little squares that some of them, do we have them here somewhere? In offices, the louvers. These guys are to direct, again, diffusers to distribute the light evenly. Especially the diffusers, guys. Diffuser distribute light evenly. Evenly. And movements also work to distribute light, but both of them have another function as important. Both of them has a very important function, guys, is hide the lamp. What do you want to hide the lamp? Comfort probability factor, they call it, comfort probability factor. They have a very important role that they play, all of them, and comfort, that's the term that they use, comfort probability factor. And hide the lamp. Why do I want to hide the lamp? You want to hide the lamp because if you are looking at the fluorescent light, it's annoying, it's irritating for your eye. So first they distribute the light evenly, both of the louvers and the diffusers. And another side effect for it, guys, is hiding the lamps because it increases the comfort probability level. So you feel like reducing better under these type of light. Because if I'm looking right now at the light source, the lamp, it really irritates your eye. Put some stress in your eye, glare, and getting rid of glare. Hide the lamps for glare, miss the glare. Glare. Get rid of glare. So that's my my diffusers. Lamps, your choice, guys. You can we talked about multiple lamps, guys. You can have incandescent, you can have fluorescent lamps, you can have high intensity discharge, and you can, if you're environmentally friendly, like check ELD, or you can have induction. So any one of these lamps could be in this luminaire. Any lamp could be in this luminaire. Ballast. So the lamps, we talked about the lamps, we just finished talking about lamps, guys. What do you think the ballast do? We said two functions mainly for the ballast that I know of. Number one, start, arc, and maintain arc. That's what they do. The ballast start the arc, pump the voltage high. We have an arc. Now the arc is established. What do I need to do? Choke the current so I can maintain the arc. Start the arc and maintain the arc. That's what the ballast is. And obviously you can use, we know where they use a ballast with, right? High intensity, you use them with high and low intensity lights. You don't use it with LEDs or induction or incandescent. Okay. Power connection, what do you use a power connection for? Circuiting. You need to circuit that baby, right? So you have a power connection. When you terminate, guys, you have to terminate in a little box or in a fixture. So you have to have a place where you can terminate, lugs where you can terminate. Any question about the luminaire? Almost every luminaire, guys, have this type of arrangement. LEDs, instead of having a ballast, they have an electronic device that can convert the AC to DC and pump them directly through the LEDs. LEDs. So any questions about these? What aluminum is, why do we have it? I can't emphasize that, especially everybody knows everything except the most confusing ones I over the years, guys, is reflectors and diffusers. As you start going through the catalog of Lithonia, they will ask you what type of diffuser and what type of reflector do you need. And obviously, if you don't know, you don't know, but there's a certain standards, guys. Certain set, like this diffuser right above your head, there's multiple types of diffusers like this. Which, what's the cell, how many cells do you need in this diffuser or in this louver? So there's a few. What I do, guys, if I don't know the fixture, I always personally I call the fixture a fixture whip. They're much smarter than you and I. They do it for a living. They know that, that every single type of diffuser that God created for every fixture that they sell. So they're the resident expert, especially the reflector and the diffuser. The balance, I can't emphasize that the balance right now, almost all of them are electronic. Electronic balance, efficient, efficiency is the most efficiency. You can dim it, you can turn it on and off. So electronic balance, in the past, they used to have, 1 second, Mr. Bell, you can use electromagnetic balance. A coil, basically. They used to have a coil. Now the most efficient one is electronic balance. You take the power over here, you chop it into little pieces at different frequency, and you dump it across the arced fixture. And if you read about the balance, guys, unreal. They change the 60 hertz into thousands of hertz, and they dump it right across the fluorescent light. So the fluorescent light is no longer, the arc is no longer maintained by 60 hertz, maintained by thousands of hertz. So they have a whole lot of way of manipulating the 60 hertz signal to make it more efficient when you dump it across the arc in a fluorescent light. Yes, Mr. Bell?
I have a problem. Diffuser,
mover. Distribute, if I spell it right, distribute the light. And both of them hide the lamp. Why? Because of a glare. Right? Because of glare.
What does it say again?
Hide lamp?
No, lamp four.
Number four, lamp.
Which is the red?
The red is incandescent lamp, fluorescent, LED, high intensity discharge. There's an LED. Why did I see the LED here? LED, thank you. LED, and induction. The type of the lamps that we just covered, guys, in chapter 2. Any question, guys, about the luminaires? This is really, as you read through it, this is what the chapter talks about, the housing and details and so forth. I want to bring to your attention, all this business creates something called coefficient of utilization, very important concept called coefficient of utilization. So I'm going to use, really, the coefficient of utilization is a function, all of them, all this, can create something called coefficient of utilization. Coefficient CU, coefficient of utilization. Coefficient of utilization for every fixture, Brad, the way you do the reflector, the way you choose which reflector, which diffuser, which lamp, which housing, the shape of the housing, the ballast, based on all this, it has a label that called CU, coefficient of utilization. That's the efficiency of the fixture. So we're going to look at this one based on how many lamps, based on how many ballasts, the type of the fuse, they give it a 50% coefficient of utilization. What this means, guys, when we talk about this one, 50% of the light that comes out of this fixture based on all these criteria that it's built in will reach the destination. What happened to the other 50? It's going to go absorbed by the by equipment, divert somewhere else. So please, please pay attention that coefficient of utilization is a function of all these characteristics or elements of aluminum. Which means, Brooks, if you go change the reflector, the coefficient of utilization of the fixture will change. So as you pick your fixture, based on your picking the louvers, all the stuff, it's going to be assigned a coefficient of utilization. Coefficient of utilization. Who cares, Mr. Urbab? You're going to be plugging these numbers in the software, and you're going to be plugging them by hand when you do the calculation. coefficient of utilization. Every manufacturer respected, which all of them are, most of them are, you're going to have guys, every fixture that you buy is going to have a coefficient of utilization based on the characteristic they picked. So you're not alone. Okay, so that's basically about the fixtures. I want to talk a little bit, the second one, guys. Any question about this? Really, this section has three things I want to talk about. First is a luminaire. Second is the application of luminaire, and you guys can read through it. And the third one is the photo. I always get that one as photometric characteristics. So isofoot candle curves or photometric characteristics. Two words for it. So three things. Any question about that, Mr. Abel? Hide the lamp.
What is the upper what?
The upper is glare. Why do we hide the lamp? Because we don't want to glare. Am I right? Because you look directly into a light fixture. Does it make you feel good? Unless you are my son, 7 years old, staring at something. It doesn't make you feel good. The older you get, like DJ, for example, the worse it gets. Okay, Mr. Babs, see you coefficient of utilization. All this info, guys, is in the book. I'm just picking what I think is the most important thing and putting it on the board. Okay, the second section, guys, is application. That's the first part of the chapter. The second part is application. Application of these fixtures. When you apply these fixtures, the first thing I want to say is inside, and I have another one for outside, and I have third one is hazardous location. These are all application of fixture. You can put them in hazardous location. We have the voltage that comes with it. We have the watts, and we have lumens, and you can read through it, lumens. And another factor here is ambient temperature. I know I spelled ambient wrong. Ambient temperature, another thing I want to touch on. Ambient temperature, VCP, we'll touch on that one, and we're going to touch on mounting this fixture. So these are what I picked from the whole application system. These are the most, what I think, the most important things about applying the fixture in different locations. Okay, if you are inside a building, you have to pay attention to these fixtures. Really, if it's inside or outside, the only difference is it dry or wet location or damp location. Very important. If it's a dry location, the fixture has to be a dry location rated. So very important here. Out. So we have this is have to be dry. This is have to be wet. So what does that mean? If you're using a fixture outside, exposed to the elements, it has to be a wet location fixture. You're using it inside, it has to be a dry location fixture. Can I use a wet location fixture in a dry location? No problem. The opposite is not true. I can't use a dry in a wet location. So that's basically what inside outside. As you pick, Muhammad, my friend, as you pick a fixture for your application, always you're going to ask yourself, is this location wet location or dry location? Or damp location? Damp or dry or wet? Damp or dry or wet? Any question is about that? And the code talks about this one, the NEC code. The second thing is hazardous location. Hazardous location, guys, I'm going to remind you, and in the book they talk about it, there's a class 1, div 1 and 2, and also class 2, div 1 and 2, and the last one, as a class 3, div 1 and div 2. These are the classified flammable gases and vapor, flying combustible dust, and flying fibers. If you have a hazardous location, which we don't have in this project, next project we will have a class 1 div 1 location. So what you have to do when you find, here's what we did, guys, next project. you need an IES file for a fixture in a class 1 div 1 location. So we went, we picked a class 1 div 1 location for our next project, and then the first thing we did is we contacted the manufacturer to get an IES file so we can pull it into visual so we can do the calculation. So the only thing I want to say, without getting you guys into the details of explosion proof, if it's class 1 div 1 location, dust type is if it's a class 2 location, if I remember right. So the most important thing is if you have a class area classified by the architects, the engineers, and so forth, you have to make sure that your fixtures match the classification. That's all. And the manufacturers, guys, are very smart. They classify them as, with a group even, especially class 1, div 1, they will be group gas group 1, 2, 3, or A, B, C. And so just if you're in a hazardous location, the most important things to understand is you need to make sure that your fixture is rated for that hazard. Any question, guys, about the classification? Hazardous location, explosions. Hazardous location. So that's location. Where are you going to apply it? The first thing you're going to ask yourself, Mr. Irbab, do I have a hazardous location application in my building? Yes, then I need to go which hazard, and I want to make sure that the label sensor on the fixture says labeled for class 1, div 1, 2, or a class 2 or 3. Most of the time, guys, if it's, as you know, if it's class 1, div 1 rated, it covers everything else. So what the manufacturers do is they have a class 1, div 1 that covers everything else. The only difference is if you put a class 1, div 1 fixture in a class 3, div 1 or 2 location, it's like shooting a mosquito with a tank, with an artillery, right? It's expensive. So that's why they have like class 3, especially class 3, div 1 and div 2. You need to have tight and cascaded and all this good stuff. It's cheaper fixture. So, but all of us know, guys, from top of the hazard is the first class 1 is the most hazardous location, and class 3 is the least hazardous location, right, in terms of danger. Gas versus flying fibers here. I mean, I can handle flying fibers more than I can handle an explosion in natural gas right here. Or diesel. Backward in terms of number A?
Yeah,
the class 1 is the worst. What did they say? Did they say it the other way? I could have. Class one div one is the worst of the worst.
Worst situation.
Yes. Okay. And class 3 div 2 is the least. How are you gonna say that? Is the least hazardous location. Okay. Any questions about this? So these are the applications. Voltage very important, guys. Voltages, you can buy them any voltage, but here's what you should apply, Brad, as you start specifying your fixture. It's almost always, when I worked with LV Beckett, is we say multi-voltage balanced. Always, if you have your choice, it's a little bit more spendy, but always use with your fixture multi-voltage, meaning you can bring a multi-voltage, guys, you can bring 120 to it, 208, you can bring 277, and you can bring 480 to the same balanced. So if your wiring system, as if you're burning this fixture at 480, you bring a two phases to the fixture and you burn it at 480. If you're bringing it at 277, you bring a neutral and a phase, no problem, to the same ballast. If you're bringing it at 28, 120, either you burn it at 208, two phases, or 120. The most common burning voltages, guys, for fixtures indoor are 120 and 277. That's the most common. Outdoor fixtures, they burn them at 208 and they burn them at 480. They send two phases and burn the fixtures. Why do you think we send the 480 in a parking lot? The higher the voltage, the least the voltage drop. Voltage drop issues. In tunnels, they even burn them at 600 volt. They send the voltage 600 volt and burn in all these tunnels, like interstates, and you have one right here, what do you call Lowry Tunnel here. These are allowed all the way up to 600 volt to be burned. The fixture is burning at 600 volt, two phases. Okay, so if I have my choice, I would say here multi-voltage. Everybody knows what a multi-voltage is. Then you can bring 120, 208, you can bring 277, you can bring 480, or you can bring up to 600, some of them, not all of them. You can almost, and if you go look at the catalog, guys, it says multi-voltage, and they list the voltages that you can bring to the same ballast. So that's the best ballast that you can have.
the best, and we're talking about ballast here, by the way, because 95% of the time, if you're in a commercial industrial building, you are using a ballasted fixture. So any question has about the multi-voltage, please always specify multi-voltage. What if you guys fixtures, oh boy, you can get fixtures from, I'm going to say just 5 watts into thousands. I throw here 3000 watts, and even higher. You can go buy a fixture from 5 watts all the way to 3000 watts, big fat fixtures, especially the outside big ones. So that's the only thing that I want to mention, that one. Lumens, my friend, I want to, lumens is the amount of light coming out of fixture, and I have, you can buy, a lot of them are 3,000 lumens come in, all the way to 6,000 lumens, and you could get even higher than that, floodlight. Floodlights, they can get you 32,000 lumens, these big floodlights and the poles, they can get you, but the most coming inside, 3,000 to 6,000 lumens. These ones, 3,000 lumens each lamp. So if you have 3 lamps, multiply this by 3. Lumens. What's a lumen? The amount of light coming out of the fixture as it burns the watts. When it burns the watts, gets you lumens, light. Any question guys about these? And please read the chapters. Can you guys do it one time for your friend Chad? Okay, and I'm moving fast on these because I really want to concentrate a little bit on more important things. Ambient temperature. Ambient temperature is very important, guys. Most of them can go from negative 40 to plus 50 or something. A lot of fixtures, I'm going to throw this number, and I hope you prove me wrong, probably negative 20 Fahrenheit, obviously, into, negative 20 Celsius, I don't know, Fahrenheit, Celsius, negative 20 Celsius all the way to probably 50 Celsius, from negative 20 Celsius to 50 or somewhere in between. So meaning they can tell you can put it anywhere. You can put it all the way in the desert, the same fixture, but the efficiency of the fixture changes as the temperature goes up, guys. The efficiency of the fixture change. Okay, I'm going to leave the VLP until the end. Mounting, there's a couple of ways of mounting a fixture. You can have recessed, okay, you guys will spell it right, recessed, hung, or you can have surface mounted, surface mounted, let me repeat it because it's a Greek here, recessed, hung, surface mounted, and there's probably a couple of, ways, but these are the most common. You look at this one, recessed fixture, you can have a surface. Most of the stuff, guys, indoor are recessed. Recessed, it looks better than surface mounted. You can hang it, a basket. We are specifying like a few hung ones where you can hang them 2 feet below, so it gives you direct indirect light up and down, very important. Or you can have them surface mounted, as I said, which is not commonly used in commercial. So most of the time, guys, the cheapest way in a commercial building is recessed, the cheapest way in a lot of applications. Because we have the false ceiling here, you can recess things in it. Hung is an expensive way of, you have a fixture that hung 2 feet and it shoots light up and down. It distributes the light really nice, makes you feel good underneath it. And surface mounted is not common in commercial. Any questions guys about the mounting? How do you mount the fixture? This one is, I call it comfort, what is it? Comfort probability level. Comfort probability level. Anybody read about this comfort probability level? Actually, VCP, they have it here. VCP, let me use the same terminology, VC and P. If you guys look at VCP, it's a visual comfort probability. Visual comfort probability. Visual comfort probability. Every fixture is given a factor, visual comfort probability. And that factor there is, I'm just going to say it goes from 0 all the way to 100%. What does 0 mean? 0 is very uncomfortable. Incomfortable. It's very uncomfortable to sit underneath this fixture. It makes you feel miserable. You want to beat somebody up, right? And this one is comfortable. Comfortable. Does that make sense? Very comfortable. From very uncomfortable into very comfortable. How do they do that? I asked one time the lighting. Asked the lighting guys. They put a group guys, a group like yourself. They hire them and they put the light and they let them sit under that light, do a task for a couple of hours, and then they survey them. A group of people, they survey them under that particular light. Well, how do you feel about this light? And they rate them, and then they average the value and assign a comfort, visual comfort probability value for every fixture. Because we're huggy-feely guys, there's secretaries and there's kind of soft people sitting under the light and they want to make feel good and so forth. If you talk to my wife about light, drive you nuts sometimes. Sorry, probably nothing about women, but she's so particulate about her light. And they are our customers, Ryan. You might say, who cares? Those are the guys you're going to, you go to a school, guys, you do a school in a school district, you need the teachers to be happy in their classroom. They're not happy, you'll hear about it. So you're going to make sure that comfort, you laugh about VCP, is a big deal. If the fixture is known as VCP low, you might have to, to think twice before putting that fixture in a certain application, especially in a classroom. Now, if you have a place where shipping and handling, and those guys know nothing, who ships and handles, how much do you care about light? You might put a 50% VCP for shipping and handling guys hauling things. Who cares? They don't care much. They don't complain much. It's not the type of complainer there. Now we're talking politics here. Any question guys about this? So this is what I want to highlight in this chapter. I hope it's interesting. This is PDF if you can read it. And the last thing, guys, I'm going to talk about, and I promise to let you go by not take any of your time, is I'm going to talk about the isofoot candle or photometric characteristics. I'm going to draw one little thing, guys. Isofoot candle curve. Okay. I'm in page 33. Photometric characteristics. And in particular, I will talk about the isofoot curve candle. Really, all this you don't need, thanks God, we don't need to worry about this one. In the past, they used to do it by hand, guys. It was miserable. It was miserable. What this guys means, what they do for every fixture is, here's the 180 degrees, and they take it from here, and I'm going to go just put a couple of degrees here, just as an example. So let's say here's a 25, and here's a 45, and here's a 65, and here's a 90, this section. So the fixture will be located right in the middle here, right in the middle, and obviously mine is tilted, but you can imagine. And they measure the lumen and the foot candle at every point. So if you guys look right at zero, at angle zero, so they can measure the foot candle as you move away from the fixture. And I'm looking at the one, these 500 CP right underneath it, 1,000, and I'm just putting 3,000 and 5,000. And these are curves, all these areas that located from that fixture at this particular. So if you are right here away from the fixture, you will encounter 500 CP candela power. If you move away 1,000, a little more 3,000, all the way to 5,000. The further away you get from the fixture to a point, Right underneath it, guys, you're not going to get a lot right underneath the fixture because the pole is right underneath the fixture. You're not going to get a lot. But as you move away slightly from the fixture, the light is directed to almost 45 degree. So you're going to get more candela power. Anyway, so that's that isopod candle curve. The good news is all these curves are loaded for you in visual. You really don't need to load them. That's the good news. In the past, guys, they used to pick them, draw them to scale, and place them in certain locations to find the 4-foot candle. So, but it's really a curve. It's an isopod candle curve. It's a curve that identify how many lumens located at certain points away from a fixture. Here's a fixture right here. If I move to this point right here, I'm going to have this amount of lumens. If I move to this side, I'm going to have this amount of lumens, and it goes all around the fixture if the fixture doesn't have a reflector. If the fixture has a reflector, obviously you're just looking at what's in the front of the fixture. So say if this fixture has no reflector, you're going to find all these values all around the fixture. Most of the time, we direct this light in one direction. That's why they take one quarter out of this circle, and they show you the isopod candle for one quarter, because most of the fixture are directed to almost a quarter or at least 180 degrees, just right in the front of it. I want you guys to look to, I want you please to look at page 33. In page 33, they made it very clear, clearer than I did. Page 33, the upper right, it says photometric characteristics of 70 all the way to 150 watt high pressure sodium luminaire. And I want you guys to look at that. If you don't want to look at the curve, just look at the table next to it. At zero angle away from, at zero angle, here's the fixture sitting right here. At zero angle, here's the angles that we're talking about. Angles, angles, all these are angles. At zero angle, right underneath, here's zero. At zero angle, guys, what's the, how much lumens you can get at zero angle for this fixture? Can you see it? 650. If you go 5 degrees, you're going to get 661. If you get 65 degree, here's a 65 degree, guys. Here's my angle right here. 65 degree angle, right at this point. How many lumens you think I'm going to get at this point? Lumens coming out of this fixture? At this angle, 3675. So, and this was, we started with what? With 650 here. And it keeps going higher and higher to a limit. And then you start going away from the fixture. So all the way up to 75, all the way to 130. So can you guys see the 130 degree, please? Angle 130. If you're 130 degree, how much lumen you get? 220. So it went all the way. Here's 130 degree, guys. 130 degree. So 130, 120. So you're going to get all the way to 90. So that almost like in that area here, shooting. So you're going to get right in here. You're going to get 220. 220 shooting somewhere away from that angle. Who cares about this? Two things. Number one, you guys are going to do, we're going to do calculation. I'm going to ask you, find me the foot candle at this angle. So all what you have to do is, okay, Chad, which angle? Angle 35, the lumens is 1086, no problem. You plug it into the area, and you can find the foot candle at this particular point. So these are how much lumen are coming out of every fixture at a certain angle. At a certain angle. These are angles from the fixture, from the vertical. Any question, guys, about reading 360, 3.6 iso photometric curves? The one underneath it, guys, isopod curve of typical fixture on a horizontal plane. There's the isopod curve. This is the photo. This one is photometric. The isopod curve, when you put that curve and you start talking, the only difference between the photometric and the isopod candle, the isopod candle, instead of giving you lumens, now they get you foot candle. So if you guys look at the bottom, it's giving you the same circles, but now at foot candles, right? Can you guys see 5 foot candle, 2.5 foot candle, 0.5 foot candle, 2.25 foot candle, and 0.1 foot candle away from the fixture. So you start getting into all the way, and each one of these is listed. This is, here's my source of power. My source of power is right here. This is 5, and this is 2.5, and this is 0.5, and this is 0.25. What does that mean? It means every single point at this that located at this curve, it's going to see 2.5 foot candle. Foot candle, not lumens. Here is lumens, guys. The photometric gives you a lumens. When you grab the photometric and you put it on an area, you slam it right on an area, it converts it from photometric characteristics into ISO foot candle. It starts giving you things in foot candle. Foot candle. That's all what you need to know about it. The good news is we no longer, so you take this curve and you slam it into a 10 by 10 foot area, and then the lumens over the area give you the foot candle. I want you guys to at least to know how to get the values from it. So if I ask you how many lumens a fixture of certain type can get at certain angles, it should be not a big deal. I want you guys to also read 3.6. It says candela power value shown are for 150 watt lumen, for 70 watt multiplied by 0.4, for 100 watt multiplied by 0.59. So they gave us this one for 150, and they give you a multiplier. They say, hey, if you're using 75 watt here, multiply this by this value, multiply it if it's 70 by 0.4. So do it. I can't emphasize, if you get certified as a lighting designer, you have to know this stuff. It really is. Any question, guys, about the ISO foot candle versus photometric characteristics? The last thing is the most important thing. Any question? Spencer, my friend, confusing as hell, no? If you guys think of the lumens, if you slam the lumens over a square foot, it gets your foot candle. That's what the ISO foot candle curve is. They took this curve, the isometric, and they put it in a foot candle in an area, and it converts it into foot candle. That's what the formula that we're going to be using is going to be doing. I want to bring to your attention, guys, and please, in page 33, 3.7, convert to new MH's mounting height multiply. So if it's this information is for a 10 foot. This was a 10 foot from here to here. All the info that you got for this picture is only if you put it in a 10 foot pole. What happened if you put it in a 20 foot? What happened if you put it in an 8 foot pole? If you put it in an 8 foot pole, multiply everything by 1.56. Can you guys see that from the table? If you put it in a 25, if you want the same fixture and raise it up 10 more feet up in the air, that will cut every single lumen at every single angle by 20.25. Every single lumen at every single angle will be cut by 0.25 if you raise the fixture from 10 to 20 feet up in the air. If you keep it at 10, then these values are given for 10. Any question, my friends? Lumens, ISO, photometric characteristics, ISO foot candle curve. I told you guys about the Ohio trip. This is exactly what they do in Ohio. They put a fixture right here in the middle of a room. They measure all the angles in every direction, and they put sensors, and they establish that 500 CP at every single location. And they create that photometric curve for this fixture. And then if you put it in a certain area, you slam it in a certain area, it will convert it from lumens into foot candle. The last but the most important things about this chapter, guys, I want you to remember, because it's going to be carrying with you, if you do lighting, it's going to be with you all your life, which is the pattern of light. It's in page 34. I'm not going to write it, I'm going to show you. Page 34. In page 34, guys, Brooks, my friend, you hear a lot about direct, indirect light. Now, what the heck is a direct, indirect light? You hear a lot as we start doing the pictures. It says, I need direct light, I need indirect light, semi-direct light. I want to bring your attention, guys, to the fig 3.8, and please study that carefully if you want to understand how they do lights.
3.8, page 34, everybody's there. Look at the first one, it says direct light. What is a direct light? A direct light is, here's a direct light, like here, 90% up, between 90 to 100% of the light, where does it go, Spencer? Down. Right? That's what a direct light is. Or it could be direct light up, completely direct light. At least direct light, 90% or higher of the fixture light, where does it go? Up. And there might be 0 to 10% go up, but most of the fixture, 90% go down. That's right here, you're looking at it. Let's look at semi-direct. Semi-direct. Can you guys see the semi-direct? Up to 40% of the light is going up, and up to 90% of the light going down. Can this be a semi-direct? Look at it. There's no way on earth. Where would the light go up? Lit what? Above the, what do you need to lit up there? If you guys are semi-direct, if you want to write yourself right now, this has to be hung. To get a semi-direct, that lighting fixture has to be hung below the suspended ceiling. You can't get a semi-direct from a fixture that's recessed. Lisa didn't see it. So that semi-direct is going to be a hung fixture. Very important. Semi-direct. Okay, general diffusers. General diffusers, guys, you have almost 50-50. So the general diffusers, that could be a lighting fixture that shoots in all the directions. That one would be, you see in parks, guys, a fixture on a pole, and they have this bulb right above it, and it shoots in all the directions. Almost equal amount of fixture light going in all directions. Does that make sense? That's a general diffuser. Here's a lighting fixture sitting right in here, and it's shooting all around it, up and down and in every direction, up, down, and in every direction, right here. There's no reflector. How can you make this? There's no reflectors. It allows just a bulb over here that allows the light to go in every direction.
That's a globe light.
That's a globe light. Thank you. Globe light. So the second one is direct indirect. Please write yourself a note. Direct indirect is very common in commercial now. Very common. Direct indirect. You can get almost 50-50, up 50 down. And you see a 40 to 60, 40 to 60. You can get anywhere in between 60-40, or you can get 50-50. So what does that mean, guys? This is, you are required in our project to have direct indirect light. You're going to hang that light, the basket light, they call it. They hang it 2 to 2.5 feet below the ceiling. And there are holes, and the bulbs will be sitting right in here, shooting the light up to the ceiling, 50% of that, if you want. And you can make holes over here, so again, these holes will allow another 50% to go down, or maybe 40%, that's how big the holes are. So that's a lighting fixture that can light the floor and the ceiling at the same time. And that makes people, that's the most buzz fixture right now, because it makes the people feel good. As you want, if you guys look at this fixture, the ceiling is dark, right, compared to everything else. So that's the cave effect. They call it the cave effect because if you look like here, these spots are darker than others, and it makes certain people, grant that they were not uncomfortable. I don't care about it, but it makes people, our customers, uncomfortable. So what they do, the architects are driving. By the way, the architects drive all these side gears. The architects, they always tell you, we will direct and direct light. So if you want to make the whole room kind of glow, everything is lit, light, ceiling, floor, direct and direct light is huge. Options. The basket, you hang it 2.5 feet, shoots up, shoots down. So that's direct indirect light. Please write yourself a note. And semi-indirect, look at that semi-indirect. Semi-indirect, most of the light actually, they don't want you to let it throw down. They want you to shoot all the light up and it bounce off the wall and come down, of course. So almost 90% of the light, it's that the fixture, there's no holes in the bottom. The fixture is sitting, the bulbs are sitting here. And all the lights are going up, shoot up the ceiling, bounce on the ceiling, goes down. This is semi-direct, and with a tiny little hole at the bottom to allow up to 10% down, actually up to 40% semi-direct. If it's indirect, completely indirect, guys, completely direct, then there's nothing in here. Almost all the light is going 90% up, bounce off the wall, up the ceiling, and goes down. Why do they do it this way? It makes the room look more lit, more appealing, and so forth. But please keep this in mind as you guys look at the visual, and you will be asking direct and direct light, semi-direct. These are very important concepts to understand. If you don't know what they're talking about when they say semi-direct, but a very important thing to understand, if you are anywhere in the indirect business, what do you need? you cannot recess the fixture. Anywhere they ask you indirect or semi-direct or direct indirect, you have to hand the fixture. You can't surface mount it. The only time you can surface mount the fixture if you are in direct mode, if you want to do the direct. Any questions about this? And they call it the light distribution pattern for luminaires, light distribution pattern. Shoots down, or if you hang it, shoots up. How much up? Depending how many holes you're going to make in the bottom of that fixture. Any question, my friends? Any question about the patterns of light? Anybody read the chapter? A few of you guys did? No? This one, you didn't read it? No? Please read it, please. This is the summary of it. But I can't emphasize in the past, especially for those of you who are going to be encouraged to be lighting designer. If you're a lighting designer, they'll get you into this isometric curve and finding information. For Chad, here's what you need to do. For the isometric curve, guys, I will ask you to go find a foot candle at angle, say, zero. And from the table, you can find angle zero, give me 650. You put it in an equation that we're going to do tomorrow, as a matter of fact. And you plug this 650 lumen, and it will tell you, based on this angle, you're going to get 50 foot candle. An equation, if you look at chapter 3, talks about the equation. Very easy. Any question, my friends? No? Seems not interest. Nobody interested in lighting, guys. You can make
pretty,
a good living.
Dry stuff, yeah.
Is it?
Yeah. I'm having a hard time.
Sorry.
On the test here.
Sorry, mister. I taught math at one time in my life. And I used to tell my students, I wish, you know, if you hate math, please don't hate the math teacher. Somebody has to do that.
I don't blame you.
But they pay us good to do that. I have Mr. Lee, if anybody wants to go, is Mr. Lee, Chinese guy. He has doctorate in lighting. Works for L.V. Beckett. Unreal. If anybody want more information, I work with him. I mean, they use GHI, I think. GHI, the software that they use. And it's science, man. It's just a whole different. All what he does, 8 hours a day, they pay him. It's not what you do. They pay you good money to sit and play with lighting fixtures in the software. I mean, I will do it. I'll do that. Where's they pay you good. L.V. Beckett. L.V. Beckett. It's an engineering firm downtown. So if anybody wants more information, guys, we'll get you into lighting, certified lighting designers, they call them, certified lighting designers. Prestigious, it's a prestigious title to have. It really is. It's all about the image, right? Say yes, man.
Yeah.
Chad Kurt is listed as a Revit expert, man. I don't know when I'm going to just because I put in my my LinkedIn. All right, thank you guys. That's all I have.